What we have now is sort of the reverse circumstance, because the economy effectively collapsed. And yet at the same time, we're seeing money supply growth that's beyond anything ever seen before in the United States. That's when you tend to get hyperinflations.
Please join us for our next live stream, Sunday, November 7th at 9 p.m. Eastern. We'll go over current events, past guests, and of course, gold and silver news. Once again, our next live stream will be Sunday, November 7th, 9 p.m. Eastern. See you then. Hello again, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Silver Bullion Television, SBTV. I'm your host, Patrick Vieira. As always, if you're new to our channel or if you haven't already done so, please do subscribe, hit the bell to be notified on updates, and give us a thumbs up. We appreciate your support. John Williams from the Shadow Government Statistics joins us once again today. John provides an electronic newsletter service that you might better know as Shadow Stats, which exposes and analyzes the flaws in the current U.S. economic data and reporting, as well as in certain private sector numbers. John provides an assessment of underlying economic and financial conditions, net of financial market and political hype, which we will surely ask him about today. It's time to saddle up and silver up for John Williams. John, welcome back to SBTV. How are you doing?
Fine, thanks, Patrick. How are you today?
I'm doing great. How are you? How are things out there in your neck of the woods?
Well, things are reasonably stable, but here in the United States, you still have the COVID rampant. It's not fully contained. You've got all sorts of arguments over vaccinations, and where the economy was shut down back in March. Of last year, very, very suddenly, it has not fully reopened. We're not fully recovered despite all the happy news in our press.
John, the Fed has for more than a decade been unable to get the official inflation rate anywhere near that 4%. And yet the official inflation rate since May has been over 5% every month. How do you view this sudden surge in the official inflation rate? And I wonder what your real inflation rate calculation is now.
Well, the reason the inflation rate is where it is today, the reason it's higher, very simply, is due to the impact of the COVID shutdown on the economy, and particularly the Federal Reserve's unfettered creation of money supply. I mean, right now, if you look at the Fed's done some funny things here, but if you look at what I refer to as the narrowest but most liquid measure, I call it basic M1, which is currency and checking accounts. Right now, that's up 97% from its pre-pandemic low. And when we talk about how things have changed, I go back to the pre-pandemic low in the case of the money supply, or pre-pandemic high in terms of, let's say, employment, because you had such great volatility following the shutdown of the economy. And when the Fed came in, to surge the money supply, after a year, looking at year-to-year change, you were getting very screwy numbers. You'd have the money supply maybe even down, or the employment looked like it was up 14% or such. But if you looked at it against the where it was before the pandemic, is actually down because it was going against the trough of April of 2020. So just as a base, I'm looking at when I'm talking about whether we're how the economy's doing or how inflation's doing or the money supply, I'm looking at pre-pandemic conditions as the standard. What we're seeing now is highly unusual in all sorts of areas.
And so, but what would you calculate the inflation rate at now?
Well, the headline number, the headline CPI, Consumer Price Index, is up year over year 6%. I have it up around 14% year over year, and that's the way it used to be calculated. I've been in this business for decades. And back in the early 1980s, actually, I have to go back a decade or so before, when Richard Nixon took the U.S. dollar off the gold standard, up to that point in time, inflation and the price of gold had pretty much stayed together. And what happened, as he went off the gold standard, we started to see higher inflation. Gold prices continued to rise, but where the gold had the discipline needed to keep things in balance there had kept inflation relatively lower. As inflation rose coming into early 1980s, the people in government found, and this is in the United States, obviously, that they had to make cost of living adjustments, increasing cost of living adjustments to things like Social Security. And in doing so, as inflation was rising, they had to make bigger payments, and this cut into the and increase the budget deficit. So what they did, I think, was unconscionable, but it was aimed at trying to keep the budget under control, was they redefined the way they calculated the consumer price index, with the effect in the redefinition of lowering the headline inflation. Now, the concept behind the consumer price index, which was used, among other things, again, to help adjust the government's payment to people in the retirement payments to keep the purchasing power constant. The concept was that the CPI would measure what was needed to maintain a constant standard of living. And that's an important concept, because what they did in order in making the changes here was not to maintain a constant standard of living, at least as it was before they started making the changes. One thing, the first thing they changed, which is a very big element, was the cost of housing. People live in homes, and cost of your housing is major component. What they did was they redefined it from including, let's say, the cost of buying a new home, which was an element of the whole package there, to what they now call the homeowner's equivalent rent, which is what the government determines the homeowner, average homeowner, would pay himself to rent his own house from himself. And then the monthly inflation would be determined by how much the homeowner would raise the rent on himself going forward. Completely imaginary number, nonsense. But it had the effect in aggregate of knocking roughly 1.5 percentage point off the headline CPI. Annual rate, and that they're still doing this. And putting that in perspective, in the United States, the headline inflation last year was 1.3%. So that means just that one element alone cut the actual inflation, the way people used to view it, the way you needed to maintain a constant standard of living, in half. But they've made a number of other changes over time right now that in aggregate have reduced headline inflation by about 7 percentage points. What I do with my measure is I reverse engineer what the government did so that you're still seeing the CPI the way it would have been had they not started making all these changes back in the early 80s. And on that basis, instead of being at 6% year over year, you'd be now at 14%. And that's basically a 40-year high. And the reason you're seeing that inflation is due to what the Fed has done with the money supply.
Okay. You know, the last time the inflation rate was north of 5% was around 2008, just before the onset of the great financial crisis. Do you think this current inflation rate is a warning us of a crisis ahead?
Well, it certainly is not good news. I think it's going to get worse because of the, as we're talking today, there's a lot of speculation that our Federal Reserve is going to start tapering its monetary stimulus in the next week or so, that they'll be reducing the pace at which they pump the cash into the system and the growth of the money supply. I'm not so sure they're going to do that. There's a lot of pressure for them to do it, and our financial markets are not comfortable with the high level of inflation, which is resulting from this surge in money supply growth. Again, the narrowest measure is up almost 100%. The broadest measure, which is the old M3, I estimate M3 as well, We look at M2, which is now the official gloves. You're up with that. You're up about 40% from the pre-recession trough. So it's how any way you look at it, we're seeing growth here that's never been seen before. But you pump the excess money supply into the system, that creates inflation, drives the inflation. And particularly where you have shortages, as we have now, and a weak economy, when people look at the velocity of money and the speed at which you take the level of the money supply and the level of the GDP, and you divide the money supply into the GDP, most inflation forecasters will say, well, the higher the velocity, the greater the inflation is going to be. And that's true to a certain extent, because usually when you have a heavy turnover there, you have a strong economy. And with a strong economy, you do get inflation. But that's more normal inflation driven by the regular economic factors, supply and demand. What we have now is sort of the reverse circumstance, because the economy effectively collapsed. Now that's come back, but it's still shy of where it should be. And yet at the same time, we're seeing money supply growth that's beyond anything ever seen before in the United States, so that you have a very low velocity of money. And when you see that, that's when you tend to get hyperinflations. If you look at the Weimar Republic, Venezuela, Zimbabwe. We're dealing here with the U.S. dollar, world's reserve currency, and it's being debased in a manner that's not been seen before. I mean, we've had higher inflation, but we've never been pumping the money like we have now. And you're going to see, if the Fed does not taper, and I don't think they're going to, you're going to see that continuing to increase. And the reason I don't think they're going to taper is that the actions they're taking basically are to protect the banking system. What you have to keep in mind is that the U.S. Federal Reserve is owned by the banks. It's not a government agency. And they do whatever they have to do to keep their clients healthy. You look back into our Great Recession in 2007, the banking system collapsed. And people may not like what I would have was suggesting at that time, is say, oh, too bad, let the banks collapse and let's reorganize it. Instead, the Fed did everything it could, pump whatever cash had to be put into the system to keep the banks afloat. But in the process, they sacrificed our economy. We had the Great Recession. We've never fully recovered from that. If you look at manufacturing, U.S. manufacturing never recovered. And when I say recover, the way it's looked at economically is you see activity go above the peak level that you saw before the downturn. So that if you go back to before the Great Recession, and you look at the peak in manufacturing, then we have the Great Recession and the economy collapses. Manufacturing never got back to those levels, and it's that was due to a lot of mismanagement. In fact, I think that a lot of the actions that the Fed took back in those days brought about the banking system collapse. In fact, I know for a fact it did. The mortgage-backed securities and such were, that was a major problem. The Fed knew it. So you have that as background. And there you see them handling a direct crisis with the banks. If you look at the current numbers, what you're seeing is that the growth in our monetary base, which is basically currency and bank reserves held by the Federal Reserve banks, most of that growth, extraordinary growth, is in bank reserves. And the bank reserves right now are up something like 150% from their trough coming into the pandemic. But that's not a record high. The record high was seen back in the banking system collapse in 2007. And there you saw annual change of 5,000%. But they put all the reserves in the system, but they never took them all out. So we're operating off a much higher level of bank reserves, but you're still seeing an extraordinary jump in bank reserves, which to me indicates they're very concerned about the stability of the banking system. And that's their primary function in life, is to keep that banking system healthy. And what they're doing, the money supply, is aimed at trying to keep the banks solvent and stable. So I think the banks are still in trouble. So they're going to keep up the taper. They're going to keep the stimulus up. They're going to try and talk a good game on the tapering, which we're getting right now. We'll see how it goes. Yeah. Even if they start to taper, they're still going to be putting more cash in the systems.
I myself have wondered, you know, ever since the great financial crisis 2008, we've always heard this word recovery, economy has recovered, but the Fed has always been inducing the markets with money since 2008. I mean, how do we take these financial pundits coming on TV saying economy has recovered? I mean, has it really recovered, or how can they say it's recovered?
Well, they're trying to play to the markets and the politicians. I mean, part of it is psychological. But the average guy knows it's not happening. In fact, as we're talking, just an hour or two ago, the University of Michigan published its full survey for the month of October on consumer sentiment. It hit a effectively, the drop was historic at the time of the onset of the pandemic. Then it came back, and back in August, all of a sudden, it collapsed in a manner only seen going into a massive recession. It was not only did it collapse, but it hit a new pandemic low, and we now have so that was August, and September and October basically have stated that. That new pandemic low, it's not recovered above that. So people are knowing, they know they've got a problem here. They don't like the outlook. And indeed, we're seeing a new downturn in the economy. If you look at this last quarter, real retail sales adjusted for inflation, they contracted in the third quarter, quarter to quarter. Housing starts contracted quarter to quarter. The industrial production numbers just had a major revision on a monthly basis, but all of a sudden, where the industrial production had actually recovered pre-pandemic levels, it backed off that. Now, yesterday we had the GDP, and that was a first estimate of third quarter, and the GDP, and again, these are not real good quality numbers at the moment because of all the survey issues at hand. They just can't get really good solid numbers. But it actually minimally recovered pre-pandemic levels in the second quarter, and gained a little bit. It gained 2% quarter to quarter. But that's a little misleading because that with all the growth was in inventories. Inventories increased. People aren't selling their product. So if you look at what's called final sales, it actually contracted by 0.05%. wasn't a big contraction, but it was down. And that's where supposedly the economy is just booming along and recovering. It's not happening. One area at the moment. Now, I study these numbers and look for unusual twists. The one series that I think is reasonably accurate at the moment is payroll employment in the United States. That's as broad an economic measure as you'll find. It counts the number of people who are being paid to work. And the reason I think it's a good quality number is that it's counted from payroll tax filings by the companies that are employing people. If the people are being employed, they have to file the payroll tax return, and that gives them account, gives a government account. And right now, the level of payroll employment in September was down 3.3% from its pre-pandemic high. Now, that's not recovered, but putting that in perspective, if you look at the, it's well off bottom. I mean, it's down 10 or 12% at one point. So it's recovered a lot, but at its current level, it's still down more than the seen at the troughs of the last seven recessions back to 1957, except for the Great Recession. It was down more at its trough. But right now, if you were looking at any of the last seven recessions, you never saw the payrolls from the pre-recession peak to the recession trough drop by 3.3% or more. So we're not recovered. And the average guy knows it. The politicians play the game. They always talk it up. And of course you have Wall Street, which is always trying to boost stocks and everything it can. And people put forward a happy picture. But the underlying reality is not so positive, and the average person is not doing that well. And the average person knows it.
Yeah, I completely agree there. You know, John, we've had low interest rates for so long, and it just absolutely discourages savings, encourages spending, borrowing, even leveraging. Is the inflation rate signaling that interest rates are just too low? But if the Fed does raise rates, if they can, how high can they even go?
Well, that's a good question, because you have, normally interest rates tend to keep up with inflation. The idea behind interest is it helps you maintain the real value of your money. So if you've got inflation at 6% and you're not looking at really any interest, you're losing 6% on the money, the cash that you're holding. Well, you get around that's old precious metals, such as gold and silver. But the I think we're going to see a much worse inflation picture here. Again, I don't think the Fed's going to stop tapering. We'll see. We'll see in the next week. I may be wrong on that. They may pull it back a little bit, but again, they're going to keep pushing the money supply hard to keep the banks as solvent as they can. And with that, you're going to see an acceleration in the inflation. At the same time, the economy is beginning to pull back. And I'm looking at the potential here of the inflation getting very bad, actually evolving into hyperinflation at the same time that the economy's collapsing, sort of a hyperinflationary economic collapse. Very, very difficult time.
Okay. Inflation, hyperinflation. Inflation is heading higher. Is it just pointless already to save money? I mean, do you think such an environment encourages increased risk-taking in financial vehicles to try to even maintain a person's purchasing power?
Well, let me put it this way. It's going to be difficult for your standard investments to keep up the pace. I mean, stocks tend to follow inflation, but the if you have an interest-bearing instrument, unless it adjusts to the interest adjusts to inflation, you're going to be falling behind. And as rates rise, the value of the instruments are going to decline. Again, the one area that over time has maintained real purchasing power is the precious metals. One thing I did with my inflation numbers, I publish my estimates of inflation on a monthly basis along with the government, and where our annual growth rates start diverging in early 1980 when the government was playing its games to reduce the number, and my number keeps going up. I, at one point in time, and I don't know why I hadn't done it before, but I just said, well, let me plot both inflation numbers against the price of gold. And I plotted gold against inflation going back to the beginning of the founding of the United States. And I just took year-end gold price. Well, when I set up my index, and I also indexed the CPI to it, I set 100, I think it was around 1970 at the time that Nixon floated the dollar against gold. Well, it so happened that the price of gold and my index level were not that far apart in the big scope of things. And when I plotted the two together, what I found was over time, going back to the founding of the Republic, inflation and the price of gold moved together and continued right up to date with my number. But when you look at what happened with the headline consumer price index, when they start playing around with your gold's going up like this, my number's going up like this, and the government's number's going like that. So if you're living off the government's inflation number, you're losing your purchasing power. If you hold the precious metals, now it jumps all over the place, as you know. But over time, that will the gold and silver as well, although I've not done the same graphic work with that, but the concept's the same. It's that will preserve the purchasing power of your wealth over time. If you hold the physical metal, I'm telling people in the United States, given the unusual circumstances that we have here, I would look to hold the physical precious metal, because times if they get real unstable and you start to see a hyperinflation, then you have very, very difficult times. I knew people who lived through the Weimar Republic and in Germany and some of their children, and we talked about some stories in the when the hyperinflation hit, it was very rapid. Nobody really saw it coming. All of a sudden, the store shelves were empty, and people didn't know what to do. But if you came into that crisis, the prices were accelerating out of control, and we're not there yet in the United States, far from it. But it's moving in that direction. For example, if you went out for dinner at night, go to a restaurant, you negotiate the price of your dinner beforehand because the dinner cost for after dinner. You had a nice bottle of wine with a dinner, expensive bottle of wine. By the next morning, that bottle of wine, empty glass, was worth more scrap glass than it had been worth the night before, filled with expensive wine. That's just the early part. As it gets into it, you end up with, it doesn't make any difference what kind of a bond you have. It's going to be worthless. There's no way that you can escalate the interest on that fast enough. So it's a time where you need to batten down the hatches a little bit, as they say, and hold the physical metal. If we have difficult times here, I don't know that they're not going to close banks. So if you have gold coins in a safe deposit box, you might have trouble accessing. I don't know. It's just a matter of using common sense, playing it safe.
That's a great point. Amen to all of those points that you just said there. You know, John, speaking of gold, the energy index rose, I believe, some 24.8% over the past 12 months as all major energy component indexes increased. Gold is still in the red compared to last year. Is the gold price accurately reflecting inflation, as you just touched on? It's just not there yet.
Well, gold is not at the moment. In fact, if you look at my chart, the historical relationship between the inflation and year-end inflation, and gold should close out the year a little over 2,000. That would be a consistent number. I mean, again, it's not exact over time, but it goes up and down. But there's a leading relationship there. Gold tends to lead. And but I think what you're seeing here is that you have some people who don't want the gold price to soar against other potential investments such as stocks. You have a lot of manipulations in the market. But as inflation hits harder, the demand for gold and silver should accelerate, and that will eventually dominate the market.
Yeah, I agree. We are seeing a lot of interest in gold and silver, a lot of new people moving into gold and silver, and it's because it does have a dual purpose, where on one hand it is a hedge against inflation, and on the other hand it's a sort of insurance against what looks like it's going to be coming down the road. In your opinion, John, do you see gold as both an insurance and an investment, or do you see it as in some other way?
It certainly can preserve your life in difficult times. It's well established as an inflation hedge over time. And in this type of environment that we're in here, the physical gold and silver are what I would look for basically as the hedge against inflation. I've been to gold shows and around the country here, and a year or two ago in San Francisco, I was at one and met a lady who's talking about her family and how they all owed their lives to gold that they had set aside back in the days around World War II because of gold. And they happened to be of Jewish ancestry. They were able to bribe border guards to escape. In that type of an emergency, that type of circumstance, there's nothing like gold or silver. And when you get a hyperinflation, that's a similar type of circumstance. You no longer have a stable economy, stable circumstances. But you're out, let's say, in farmland, and you can offer the farmer silver coin or gold coin for some corn in his field, that'll be a lot easier to work than try and give him a dollar bill that's worthless. Look at what happened in Zimbabwe. Now, that was an unusual circumstance. It's probably the worst hyperinflation ever seen. I'm sure you've seen the bills where one time the standard bill was a $2 bill, and the equivalent a couple of years later was $100 trillion bill. And you wonder how they could survive like that. Central banker was proud of what he was doing, because he said, I'm just doing what the Federal Reserve does. And in many ways, he was, although not quite to the magnitude that they're doing now. But that's what, when you behave as the Fed is behaving now, and it accelerates, and we're seeing it accelerate in terms of what's being created, that's when you start to get the danger of the hyperinflation, particularly where you don't have a strong economy. But what they did in Zimbabwe was they had a backup of the U.S. dollar. If you would you work and you got paid in Zimbabwe dollars, and it was the purchasing value that was just depreciating moment by moment. So as soon as you got paid, you'd run down to the black market and convert it into U.S. dollars, and you'd hold those U.S. dollars. It'll be interesting to see how that happens in the United States if people take their U.S. dollars and scramble down to the gold market and try and trade it for some gold or silver. The silver is a little more, it's lower in per unit cost, and that I think is where a lot of people will be moving.
Yeah, you brought up some good points there, because we are already seeing, I believe in Venezuela, some people are using flakes of gold to pay for some day-to-day things. Lebanon is experiencing some pretty severe hyperinflation, and they do have to go into the black market, as you just touched on. But these places, they also use U.S. dollars as a parallel currency to their local currency. Should this happen in the U.S., where are people, what's the parallel currency to that U.S. dollar going to be? Because there's really nothing else as far as within the borders of the U.S.
Yeah, no, that's a good point, that there is nothing at the moment. It is, again, that's where, particularly in the United States, I advocate people hold the physical precious metals so that they have that, and they have it in hand, for the preserved wealth. If you have, again, if you have it in a bank or something that's being stored for you, and you can't get access to it, and you get into this real crisis, and I'm talking the hyperinflation crisis, where you need to use the gold to or silver to barter for your livelihood, having it in a bank's not going to help you. So that's unusual. I mean, it would obviously, you want to keep it as safe as you can, and there people have ways of figuring out how to do that. The going back to the Weimar Republic again, the as the circumstances devolved, one the father of one of my friends had taken his shirt and traded it for a can of beans, and took the can of beans home for dinner. Unfortunately, when he opened the can, the beans had gone bad. So, I mean, there's nothing quite perfect there. At least it's that where the canned goods and such become barterable items, as would a small silver coin. You get the bigger bullion coins or such, that you know, those will be, there's a storage of wealth, and you can maybe trade it for a house or something. But you need this, you need the small change as well. And again, looking at an emergency circumstance, as opposed to just standard and holding your gold over time as a good investment. You probably do better with coins, because those you can barter with. People don't have to assay it. They'll accept if they recognize a coin as being from a legitimate mint, they won't have to assay it. But if you're dealing with the bars or such, some people are going to want to assay it, which doesn't make it quite as liquid. But that's it, just an aside. I mean, if it's good silver, good gold, it's always going to be worth what it's what's indicated. It just may not be quite as liquid in a barter market.
Kind of wondering, you know, hey, if we get inflation and then you're you go, because your job won't increase your pay, and everything around you is going to be going up, where things around you you're going to have to be paying more for, and then you may not be able to pay your mortgage after
well,
that.
That's true. I mean, if you're paying it out otherwise, except if you hold some gold and silver,
yeah.
you can take an old American silver quarter, and you could use that, I'm sure, to pay your mortgage. It's I mean, that's, or barter it for it. It's the precious metals will retain their real value, and they're portable and liquid, unlike a house, but the real estate is a similar concept in terms of maintaining its value. And the if your cash flow is impaired, that's a problem. because your income's not going up. But again, if you have the precious metal, that's it'll be going, it's, it will be retaining its purchase power, purchasing power. Again, take that quarter to buy a beefsteak or whatever, wherever you are in the cycle, it'll reflect however bad the inflation is. So if you're trying to think of things that would go up in price, I mean food prices obviously. Well, but again, that's where the store of wealth comes in, because that will.
Right, because the lesson we learned from talking to some guys in Lebanon is we saw the food prices went up day to day. It changes fuel prices day to day. It changes if you can even get it, and supplies start to become, you know, limited, which pushes up the price even more. And so we see that with them, and then you got to kind of wonder, well, okay, well, how do you pay for your mortgage? And I guess, like you said, this is where you may need things like physical gold and silver.
Yes. I'd certainly be prefer to be holding physical gold or silver than a stack of $100 bills. Because a stack of $100 bills can become worthless, but the gold and silver will maintain their purchasing power.
John Williams, before we wrap up, can you let our listeners know more about your work at shadowstats.com and what your services provide?
Well, I publish a newsletter called Shadow Stats. It gets out roughly once a month. I'm sort of a little bit of a hiatus here right now. I've got a big one that's about to come out. That's a subscription service, $175 a year, $89 for 6 months. But also on my site, which is shadowstats.com, if you look at my homepage, after 3 months, all the newsletters are open to people. And on the right-hand column of my homepage, there's a thing called the daily update. And we just start scrolling down that. I update it every day for the numbers that are released and the basic outlook. And you get a pretty good idea of what I'm looking for if you scroll down on that. It's a fairly lengthy column, but all the numbers are covered. And for subscribers, I'm always available by phone and the email. I always go back and forth with people. I get a lot of good feedback from my clients, and because they'll have questions on their business, but you also get a sense as to how the economy's going.
Okay. John Williams, we appreciate the time you've given, and I hope we can do this again soon.
Well, thank you again so much for having me, and be happy to do it anytime.
That was John Williams sharing his view on the overall economy. If you want to see more of John's work, go to shadowstats.com. As a reminder, audio-only versions can be found on iTunes and Spotify. And if you like this video, please do subscribe, share, and give it a thumbs up. It helps us to continue to do what we do.